Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here with the United States of Egypt, part 3. And I'm going to go ahead and end this specific series with this part. It'll be a trilogy. And so I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to grab some extra stuff that I didn't touch on in the first two parts. I'm going to address one interesting thing that kept coming up concerning the name of California. So if you guys don't want to miss that, make sure you stay around for the whole study and go ahead and hit that thumbs up button as you come on to the channel. Let's see. Oh, and there will be an announcement at the end. Yeah, an announcement at the end about the Olivet Discourse. As a matter of fact, I'll just make it right now. I'm going to be doing a series on the Olivet Discourse. Specifically, I've touched on it before, but we're going to go over the whole Olivet Discourse in context, what Christ was talking about, what he was referencing, and we're going to pick out all the Old Testament references that Christ said had to happen before the end of the age so that all that was written may be fulfilled. All right, so you guys know how we do. Before we get into the study, today's study is brought to you by the Royal Judah Shoes. If you don't have a pair of the gold or the platinum, let me see, you can get a discount if you put your email in there when that pops up. If you don't have a pair of the gold, the platinum, or the onyx, make sure you grab you a pair. The link to all three will be on the link page and in the description, possibly in the comments as well. Shout out to all the moderators who have been sharing the links to everything as well. Now, if you guys want more history, I don't have it up on the page right now, but you can go to blackhistoryinthebible.com if you guys are looking for even more references to some of the historical stuff, you know, that gets talked about over here. I know a lot of people, for whatever reason, a lot of people on the other side, they promote ignorance. For some reason, they are mad about all these sources that are coming out. They weren't mad that the history happened. They're mad that we're actually teaching the history. They're not mad at the people who lied to them by omission. They're mad at us for showing the history. And it just shows the level of lack of intelligence over on the other side. They prey on ignorance. And yeah, if you want to be educated, go to blackhistoryinthebible.com and also research this stuff for yourself. All right, next thing. This is the Israelite Apologist Handbook. It is 100% free. The link will be in the description. It tells you how to handle the opposition. It gets deep into a lot of stuff. This is an ongoing project. It is 100% free. For those of you wondering what free books you can get, this is one of the free books right here. And the way it's done, some of you guys will see as you get into it, you can click these and open up different sections, and everything is sectioned off, and it even includes videos for you guys. So it's unlike any of the free books out there right now. And anybody that's interested in you know, having an answer for the questions or comments or rebuttals or opposition that may come your way when you're, you know, trying to tell people about the truth that they don't want to hear for whatever reason. They hate anything good to do with, you know, our people. But if it's about somebody else, they'll accept that without a single source. But if it's us, you have to bring 1,000+ sources to get their attention. But anyway, anybody that's interested in learning how to handle themselves in a apologetics way as an Israelite apologist, check this out. I've recently, when this is version 2.0, which recently came out, this right here is a response to Jude 3 Project. There are 10 things to study before engaging Black Hebrew Israelite. This is a point by point rebuttal of all their points. So you guys could click these, open these, and really, really get some good responses to some of their stuff. Let me see. Do you have an accurate account of the transatlantic slave trade? That is actually one of theirs right there. And I'm going to be adding some videos to this section as well. But anyway, go ahead, grab that for free. The link will be in the description. Oh, here comes an announcement. These are the last couple before we go ahead and get into the study. So, if you guys do not have a copy of Undeniable Full Color Evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible, make sure you grab your copy. This book came out in 2019. As you can see, 1,191 reviews, rated 4.8 out of 5 stars, available in paperback and on the Kindle and on most other digital platforms as well. And just quick ranking, it is still number 3. Came out in 2019, 3 years ago. Number 3 in history of ethnic and tribal religions, number 7 in Messianic Judaism, and number 8 in Christian theological anthropology. And real quick, if we click bestsellers in Messianic Judaism, I believe they have a category called most wished for. This used to be in the top 10 most wished for. Oh, there it is right there, number four most wished for book in Messianic Judaism. Ask yourself why is it that Messianic people that are either Messianic Jews or interested in Messianic Judaism, why is this the number four most wished for book in the category if everything we've been saying is lies? So anyway, link will be in the description. Also, we have the large print version available for anyone with visual problems. And Undeniable 2 is coming. For those that have not heard yet, Undeniable 2 will be available this summer. It's historical evidence of Black Israelites in the Bible. The first was full color evidence. This is going to be giving a historical timeline with all the sources listed in the book for you. So if anybody's debating you about, you know, any century, some specific dates will be in there, but mostly by century. If anybody's debating you about that, you could just quickly flip to a piece of evidence from the century that they are talking about. As of right now, there are only a couple of centuries we can't so far find any sources for. I think that's the 200s AD specifically, and I think somewhere around the 600s or so, around there. I don't have it, you know, 100% off the top of my head, but there are only a couple of centuries, maybe 3 centuries, that we can't find any, or we haven't found any evidence for yet. I say yet because when this started, we didn't think we'd find as much evidence as we did. So shout out to everybody that's been helping with the Black History in the Bible Project, the curators, and everybody else. All right. So now, go ahead and hit the thumbs up button if you haven't done so already. Right here, this button right here. Please hit the subscribe button, a button you don't see over here because this is my channel. So hit the subscribe button. Click all notifications. Hit that notification or click the notification bell and turn on all notifications so you don't miss any future studies coming up. After this one's done, I'm going to put all 3 together, and in probably a couple weeks, I'm going to marathon all 3 of these together. If you want to support, you can go to patreon.com/DanteFortson and become a patron. And you can support anytime via Cash App with hashtag BHITB. You could support while we're live via Super Chat with the $ right there in the chat. And now Super Thanks has been activated on this channel. Finally, I've been talking about it for a while. They just expanded the program. So what Super Thanks is, it works just like a Super Chat, but it works in the comments section. So if there's any videos that you saw and you want to support, if you missed the live and you can't do a Super Chat, you can always come back and do a Super Thanks, and it will show up highlighted in the comments section to show that you did a Super Thanks. All right, so now let's get into the study. Now, we went over Egyptomania. We talked about it very briefly, and we're just going to do a real quick recap. And yeah, we're not going to do a full recap, but we'll just recap just enough because it's a lot of stuff we got to cover for this last part in the series. All right, so now we are at the Art Institute of Chicago, artic.edu. Link will be in the description. American Egyptomania. So how all this started, for those of you coming in on part 3, is that we went to Deuteronomy 28:68. We're going to revisit that at the end of this, or towards the end of this. And it talks about being carried into Egypt again with ships as a punishment for Israel's disobedience. Now, many of us believe, and not just Israelites, there are people in the Christian church that believe that the reference to Egypt is a future place, and that Egypt is the name it is being associated with for a reason. Them being carried into Egypt again on ships is also another indicator. And so people would like to say that this has been fulfilled. Deuteronomy 28:68 has been fulfilled. However, the evidence seems to point directly to the transatlantic slave trade if you read through Deuteronomy 28 and compare it with Black history. Now, anybody that says it doesn't, it's either one of two things happening. They're either approaching the Bible with a preconceived notion that nothing in the Bible could possibly have anything to do with the transatlantic slave trade or Black people in any sort of way. And they're approaching the text with the preconceived notion that the people in the Bible could not possibly be African Americans, what we're called over here, or Black people in America or other places taken into slavery via the transatlantic slave trade. They don't believe that we could possibly be those people at all. And again, the ones that do concede that we could be, or some of us could be the people, they don't believe that this specifically has anything to do with the transatlantic slave trade. See, they have to come with that preconceived notion because the rest of their eschatology falls apart once they start saying, yes, those are the people. Yes, those people fit prophecy. What does that mean? Read Joel 3 if you want to know what that means. Joel 3 is the direct explanation for the events in the book of Revelation. All right, so we're going to read this. This is by Alejandra Vargas Margarita Lascano Hernandez. This published July 31st, 2018. And we're just going to skim through some of the stuff, but I'm going to read this first paragraph here. Ancient Egypt has fascinated the American public for centuries. The grandeur and exoticism of its pyramids, temples, great sphinx, and culture have made this great civilization a recurring subject in architecture, film, art, and popular culture. In fact, Egyptian imagery, often taken out of context and presented as a stereotype, has been so present in American culture that it feels strangely familiar. During the 20th century, Egyptomania reached a fever pitch in the United States. Howard Carter's 1922 discovery of King Tutankhamun's tomb caused a nationwide craze, and Elizabeth Taylor's portrayal of Cleopatra in the 1963 classic film inspired a new interest in ancient Egyptian fashion. So we have a group of people, Europeans here in America, who are obsessed with Egyptians and Egyptian culture and everything to do with Egypt, and yet we are told that America can't possibly be Egypt in Deuteronomy 28:68. It can't possibly be the future Egypt. And so they have some, you know, images here of Life Magazine, Esquire, High Fidelity, and it's just showing these people, you know, and their obsession with Egypt. Chicago was not immune to the Egyptian revival craze, and many fine examples of Egyptian-inspired architecture can be found in the city. Let's talk about Chicago. Graceland Cemetery in Uptown and Rose Hill Cemetery in Ravenswood are two sites that house Victorian-era memorial tombs and mausoleums in the Egyptian style. A more modern and commercial example is a warehouse built by the Chicago-based storage and moving company Reby. Founded in 1880 by William C. Reby in 1922, the same year King Tut's tomb was discovered, the Reby Storage and Moving Company opened a historical warehouse on the 2300 block of North Clark Street. And here we go. We got pictures right here. These people were obsessed with Egypt, Egyptian architecture, and everything else. Now, people will say, well, why didn't God just say America in Deuteronomy? Well, who would come along and name their place America if it was written right there in the Bible, and they saw that this place was going to enslave Israelites and then later be judged and destroyed by God? Who would intentionally name their country America? Nobody. The United States, the U.S., any other names you want to give, nobody. So what he did was he associated it with Egypt. Why? Because America's obsessed with Egypt. America wanted to be a newer, more powerful version of Egypt. We've gone over this throughout the series. But let's keep reading. This is some interesting stuff. The building's singular facade, decorated in colorful Egyptian revival style, features an entrance guarded by twin statues of Pharaoh Ramses II. Hold on, give me a second here. Oh, that popped back down. All right. Pharaoh Ramses II. Not surprisingly, the Reeby Warehouse was designated a Chicago historical landmark in 1999. Let's keep going. Here, right here, you have Cairo. Let's see. Another Egyptian revival-style building captured by photographer and scholar Harold Allen is the Cairo Supper Club, a one-story building whose exterior is adorned with glazed polychromatic terracotta lotus-capped columns. That was harder to say than it looked. And a winged scarab medallion in the cornice. Designed in 1920 by architect Paul Gerhardt Sr., the building was first used as an automobile showroom and then housed the Cairo Supper Club from the 1940s to the 1960s. The Egyptian-themed facade, combined with the Art Deco inflected neon lights and large plate glass windows, seem to provide a vivid marriage of two different but equally influential cultures. The Egyptian-themed facade, combined with the Art Deco inflected neon lights and large plate glass windows, seem to provide a vivid... Oh, wait. I guess they double copied that. That's the same sentence we just read. All right. So here you have the Cairo Supper Club, and I'll go back up one more time. So you see right here, I think this is the winged disc of Ra, if I'm not mistaken. And then we'll see this right here. And then once again, you see the winged disc. You see the Egyptian pharaohs. So let's just keep going. Similar to the Reeby Warehouse, the Cairo Supper Club building was named a Chicago Historical Landmark in 2013 under the guidelines of exemplary architecture with unique exterior. The Cairo Supper Club wasn't the only Egyptian-inspired building that attracted Allen's attention and his camera. In fact, he made it his goal to photograph all the Egyptian revival-style architecture ever built, and simultaneously began collecting his other items that grew out the country's Egyptomania craze. Magazines, print and mass manufactured material, Wedgwood, ceramics, and memorabilia. You can experience his photographs and selections from his collection now in the exhibition. All right, so there will be a link to this, as you guys can see. He basically covered the obsession Americans had. And this is, again, an older article, so I don't know if the exhibit is still there. But, yeah, he covered the obsession that European Americans had with Egypt. And this is just, you know, Chicago stuff. So now, to show you, to give you a good idea how I dug this up, Egyptian Expedition, Archaeological Research and Excavation. So this is the Directory of North American Egyptologists. It says as of January 2020, the DNAE will no longer be updated. So this is 2 years out of date at least. But yeah, if you guys are looking for a North American Egyptologist, now, again, Egyptologist that lives in North America, here you go. And here's the contact phone numbers and emails, NYU, Brown. So this is an official list. I just want you guys to see how many names are on this list, how many Egyptologists we have in America. Why the need for so many Egyptologists in a North America? So I'm guessing some of these might be in Canada too. Just, you know, I haven't seen anything yet. I'm just thinking, since it says North America, people often forget that Canada is part of North America. All right, so this is how many Egyptologists we have in North America. So if anybody wants to find an Egyptologist and ask them some questions, they are not hard to find. Institute of Egypt Art and Archaeology, the University of Memphis, Indiana University. So it would be easy to find out how much, just caught my eye, Kemet, a modern journal of ancient Egypt. Anyway, it'd be easy to find out how much stuff in the United States is linked to ancient Egypt, I'm assuming, based on this list. So if you guys want the list, the link will be in the description And you guys can contact some of these people and start asking questions about the link of ancient Egypt to the United States or the Americas. I don't know if they cover South America or not. But this will do one of two, or it'll do a couple of things. One, it'll get you some of the answers you want and probably get you some very solid resources. But two, it'll show you that these people, the opposition, have been lying about the link of America to Egypt because they don't want Deuteronomy 28:68 to mean what we all can obviously see that it means. Their doctrine has to tell them, no, it means something else. No, it really doesn't mean that. It's okay, you can sleep at night. No. God doesn't care about Israel no more. So it's okay that you enslave them. It's okay that you lie to them. It's okay that you teach them false doctrine because God doesn't care about Israel. You're the new Israel. You're going to be raptured. You're going to be saved from all this stuff before the bad stuff goes down. You have no accountability to anything you've done in history. You don't have to follow the law. You can do whatever you want to because you have liberty in Christ and your identity is in Christ. So you can do whatever you want to on this planet. This is what their doctrine teaches. It's a doctrine that allows them to sleep at night. There's no punishment for slavery because Israel disobeyed, but they leave out the part about God redeeming them. No, that couldn't have happened. And when they say it did happen, they say 1948, even though the Bible says no man will redeem you. And if we look at the 1948 events, that was all the hand of men. It had none of the signs that we saw in the Bible as to what would happen with the regathering of Israel. We certainly don't see the aftermath of what's supposed to happen with Israel when they are regathered to the land. There certainly were no gay pride parades mentioned in my book when I read the Bible. My version of the Bible. I don't know what version everybody else has, but there are no gay pride parades in my version of the Bible, which is the King James Bible. Now, I may have a misprint. There were no people dying of melanoma at massive rates, especially the chosen people that are supposed to be in that land. Why would they be the ones dying so fast and not the people they took the land from? The Palestinians. Which, if you guys start digging into the word Palestinian, it is linked to the word Philistine. So you guys can dig into that, and later on, maybe I'll cover it in a study. But anyway, just be aware of what's happening and why these people are so against all this information coming out. So we have New Egypt Shore Region. This is New Jersey. This is visitnj.org. So press one if you guys knew Chicago had all that Egyptomania going on, and press two if you did not. So now we're going to get into New Jersey. Located within Plumstead Township, you'll find the quaint community of New Egypt. Now, a couple people did mention New Egypt in the comments, which is what led me to this. We're just going to read a little bit about it. Here, visitors can choose from an array of exciting family-friendly things to do, such as watch the race cars zip around at the clay track at New Egypt Speedway, or try their luck fishing at the Oakford Lake and Paradise Park recreational area. Antique hunters searching for the best antiques around won't want to miss the New Egypt Flea Market Village and Auction, a unique market comprised of over 40 historical buildings, some of which are original World War I barracks relocated from Fort Dix. Drive along the unpaved road to this old-time country market where you can unearth sparkling estate jewelry, rare books, collectibles, and more. So yeah, you guys, if you guys have never been to New Egypt, or some of you live around New Egypt, maybe you want to check some of this stuff out. But there is a New Egypt, New Jersey. And again, these studies on America being Egypt are to show the links and how much stuff that is here in America that can be referenced back to Egypt. It's not saying, well, here is solid proof that America is Egypt, because what I've noticed in the comments, and I just wanted to address this real quick, some of you guys think America is actually ancient Egypt. I'm not saying that at all. I'm not saying America is ancient Egypt. So for y'all coming here, leaving the comments, saying that America is Egypt, that's not being taught over here at all. Feel free to keep that on whatever channel they teach that on. So this right here is a document. It's a PDF from core.ac.uk. I'll have the link in the description for those who want to download and read through this. This is called Egyptian Mysteries and Modern Freemasonry. I'm only going to read this first part of here. If you guys want to go through and read through all this stuff about Freemasonry, you are free to do so. Like I said, the link will be in the description. It's not that long, but we're only going to read some of the first part. This is by Henry Ridgely Evans. An interesting question now presents itself. What relationship, if any, do the Egyptian mysteries bear to Freemasonry? Dr. Mackey, a well-known writer on Masonic themes, in an examination of the analogies between the ancient mysteries and the rites of modern Freemasonry, lays particular stress upon the identity of design and method in the two systems, as illustrated by the divisions into steps, classes, or degrees, to which both were subjected, visa, lustration, purification, or preparation, initiation, and perfection. The old charges are nearly all unanimous in claiming Egypt as the birthplace of the art of masonry or mystery. How far the legends of the craft are to be relied upon in this regard is a matter for learned investigation. So, we all know about the founding of this country and the Freemasons. And if you don't know, I would encourage you to do some research. So now it's linking the Freemasonry to the Egyptian mysteries, which some of us know, you know, from studying Freemasonry for a while, but many people don't know. So if you knew there was a link between Egypt and Freemasonry, press 1. If you did not know, please press 2. And it's okay to be honest. At some point, all of us did not know this stuff. So if you knew, press 1. If you did not know, press 2. So the founders of this country are linked to Egyptian mysteries, rites, and rituals. And yet they want us to believe that this has nothing to do with people being taken to Egypt on ships, even though we have a near history example of our direct ancestors being taken to a place associated with Egypt on ships. But let's keep going. We'll read this till we get down to about here. Heckthorne, Secret Societies of All Ages and Countries, Volume 1, is not very partial to the fraternity, but he says, the mysteries as they have come down to us and are still perpetuated in a corrupted and aimless manner in Freemasonry have chiefly an astronomical bearing. 100 or more works have been written to prove that Freemasonry is the lineal descendant of the mysteries. Similar claims have been made in favor of the following systems or sects: the Pythagoreans, the Essenes, the Roman Collegia, the Chaldees, the Druids, the Knights Templar, and the Rosicrucians, the medieval cathedral builders. The truth of the matter seems to be in favor of the latter. The medieval operative masons who built those superb Gothic edifices, such as the cathedrals of Cologne, Reims, Strasbourg, Notre Dame, and Westminster Abbey, originally an operative institution, Freemasonry became a speculative society to promote the practice of the moral, fraternal, and charitable principles which had characterized the old organization. So we're not going to get into all this, but it goes on to the link through the links of Freemasonry and the Egyptian mysteries. So if you guys are interested in that, this would be a good source for you. Let me see. We're going to get more into this just a little bit. We're going to look at Wikipedia. And as you guys know, we look at Wikipedia as a starting point, not an ending point. So there are just a few things on this page that stand out when you first get to the page. First of all, the Rite of Memphis and Mizraim. Who was Mizraim? Mizraim was the son of Ham, and Mizraim was later called Egypt. I'm talking about the location. Was later called Egypt. So we're talking about the same place, the Rite of Memphis, Egypt, or Memphis, Mizraim. And then we see the Ouroboros, This is the snake with the tail in its mouth, represents eternity and a few more things. Then we see the stars over here. Notice we have stars on the flag. We have the pyramid with the all-seeing eye in it. We have the compass and square down here. We have another pyramid. There's a lot of symbology on here. I think this is an obelisk. This is another compass and square here, a cross. Not sure if these are supposed to be eagle's wings or angel's wings. And we got, I think there's a trowel, if I'm not mistaken. We have the hammer. I'm guessing that's for justice. And I think this is a ladder. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on here. I think this is a rose in the middle of this cross as well. Let me see. Can I make this bigger? Barely. But yeah, there's a lot of symbols going on right there. So we're just going to read this first part. You guys can come through and read through some of this. And then what you do after that, the next step would be to Google some of the stuff that they're mentioning and then start to read some of the sources around it from different universities. People often call Google a source. If somebody calls Google a source, just understand they probably don't know what they're talking about. Google is a source aggregator. It means it pulls all the information published online into one place and serves you the most relevant information. And so universities, because it's not the 1800s anymore, universities publish information online. So when people say they have the actual books in hand and all that other stuff, it doesn't mean anything. We're in a whole new era. We're in the digital era, the age of information. So literally the same words printed in the book are published online, and you can usually read those for free. All right, so the ancient and primitive rite of Memphis Mizraim is a Masonic rite founded in Naples, Italy in September 1881 by the merger of two older rites, the rite of Mizraim and the rite of Memphis. So we just read the other source comparing Freemasonry to Egyptian mysteries, and now we get specific names, the rite of Memphis Mizraim. And so it's the combining of two rites, the rite of Mizraim and the rite of Memphis. Although founded in 1881, its predecessors have their origin in the 18th century. The system is sometimes known as Egyptian Freemasonry due to the invocation of Hermetic-derived esoteric symbolism referencing ancient Egypt in its system of degrees. The rite is noted for its high number of degrees in its system. It has 99 degrees. Though some modern French variation practice only 33 degrees. And they need a citation for that. All right. So Memphis Mizraim was governed internationally under a grand hierophant from 1881 to 1923. The first of these was Giuseppe Garibaldi, the famous military leader of the Risorgimento, who had also been Grand Master of the Grand Orient of Italy. After his death, there was a fascination within the factionalism within the organization until eventually the English Freemason John Yarker emerged as Grand Hierophant in 1902. He was succeeded by Theodore Russ in 1913, and upon his death in 1923, there was no longer an international leadership. The group in France later renamed the Grand Lodge Française du Rite Ancient et, you guys know I'm terrible at this, Memphis Mizraim continued to exist despite the cessation of activities from the international governance after Russ's death. Charles Dietrich, John Bricard, Constant Chevalon, Charles Henry DuPont, Robert Ambelaine, and Gerald Klopel were Grand Masters of the French organization. That name DuPont right there. I'll just say, pay attention to certain names. In particular, Ambelaine played a significant role in reforming the rituals of Memphis Mizraim in 1960. Since then, many different people across the world have founded their own organizations claiming descent from the Klopel lineage. I think that's Klopel, maybe Klopel. So anyway, you guys can check out all this stuff. Recognition by mainstream Freemasonry. The Rite of Memphis Mizraim is not practiced by any regular Anglophone Masonic organization. It is practiced in the Dominican Republic and Ecuador by regular Grand Lodges. In the U.S., it is under control of the College of Rites. the rite being affiliated in general with the Continental Freemasonry does not usually conform to some of the traditions of regular Freemasonry, most notably in the acceptance of both men and women by some organizations that work the rite. And then you guys can get here. It tells you the difference of the Rite of Mizraim and the Rite of Memphis. And then it talks about the combining of the two. You guys will see this pose right here. Napoleon has a pose like it. It could be a hand gesture, as some people point out. And it could just be a convenient way to rest your hand, just kind of like pockets are. Since they did not have pockets, apparently, back then, and shirts came down to their knees. I don't know what was going on back then with their clothing options, but it could be one of those two things. All right, so anyway, there's more information on the Wikipedia page. You guys can chase these down on your own. I just want to show you guys the links between America and Egypt. American Research Center in Egypt, called ARC, A-R-C-E. ARC history. This isn't anything significant. It's just interesting that America has this much obsession with ancient Egypt. And for some reason, we're told we're crazy for associating America with Egypt. ARC was formally established in Boston on May 14th, 1948. Wait a minute. May 14th, 1948, at a meeting presided over by Harvard Edward W. Forbes and Archaeological Institute of America President Sterling Dow. It was attended by some of the era's most distinguished Egyptological scholars and institutional leaders. This meeting was promoted by a growing sense in the years immediately following World War II of a great need to establish an official presence for North American scholars in Egypt. During the early part of the 20th century, leading American Archaeological Institute had conducted major excavations in Egypt. But there was no central office in Cairo supporting the field work or research associated with these institutions. So wait a minute. I often find certain things in history to be interesting. Interesting coincidences, even though I don't believe in coincidence. I find them to be funny for different reasons. But the if you guys are familiar with history, modern history, ancient history, it becomes easier to tie together certain dates. So when certain dates happen, certain things stick out. But May 14, 1948, this date is an important date right here. So ARC was founded on May 14, 1948. So America made a move towards having an academic presence in Egypt. And if you go Google May 14th, 1948 right here, I just wanted to show you guys, you Google May 14th, 1948. At midnight on May 14th, 1948, the Provisional Government of Israel proclaimed a new state of Israel. On that same date, the United States, in the person of President Truman, recognized the Provisional Jewish Government as the de facto authority of the Jewish state. So wait, so May 14th, 1948. 48. So let me see right here. May 14, 1948. So two things happen on May 14, 1948. Israel is declared a state. And for those of you who knew the exact month and day, press one. If you did not know it was May 14th, 1948, and you only knew it was 1948, press two. So These are the 1948 people it's talking about here. U.S. recognition of the State of Israel. So that happened May 14th, 1948, the same day that America established educational ties in Egypt. There's a lot of interesting things here. I don't know what that has to do with anything yet. However, I'm pretty sure there was a connection there, and I don't think those were coincidences. History.com, State of Israel proclaimed on May 14, 1948 in Tel Aviv. Jewish Agency Chairman David Ben-Gurion proclaims the State of Israel, establishing the first Jewish state in 2,000 years. And of course, we know the Ashkenazi went there, and Ashkenaz is named as a Gentile, and Christ said that Jerusalem shall be trodden down by the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles it comes to an end or be fulfilled. Creation of Israel, 1948, this is history.state.gov. Israeli Declaration of Independence, founding of the State of Israel. Declaration of Independence. So notice I didn't type in anything to do with Israel. I just typed in the date, May 14th, 1948. So sometimes you can find some interesting things in history when you know what to look for. Is that significant prophetically as far as Israel? I believe so. I don't believe they fulfilled the promises to Israel, because give me a second here. If you type in map of Israel, notice how often they show you this close-up stuff right here. They don't show you the whole thing most times, but look where Egypt is, and look where Israel is. People will firmly admit that Egypt is in Africa. Let me get this one over here. Egypt is in Africa, right? So I'm waiting for this one to finish loading. For some reason, this is a huge file. All right, Egypt is in Africa, and Israel's right here. Egypt, Israel, Egypt, Israel. Let's see if we can get a clearer map. There we go. Israel, Egypt. Israel, Egypt. I just want to point that out. This is the Sinai Peninsula, but it's considered Egypt. So when Moses was in, you know, on Mount Sinai, he was in Egypt. And where is Egypt? Egypt is in Africa. Hold on, let me I just want to pull up a Israel world map. This is Africa. This is Israel right here. Now, I'm keeping it, you know, not technical. I'm keeping it very simple for the people out there who's first time hearing this. We could get into tectonic plates and all this other stuff, but in reality, the whole Arabian Peninsula was considered part of Africa before it was changed to the Middle East. But I just want you to see the proximity of Israel to Egypt, Africa. It is literally sharing a border with Africa. And we're supposed to believe that the people over there now... Wait, why are my fingers all wrong? There we go. Now, these people live next door to Africa. This is what we're being told. These people live next door to Africa. Surprise, Ashkenazi Jews are genetically European. Live science. Egypt is next door to Africa. I'm sorry, Israel is next door to Egypt, Africa. And we're told that these are the original people, the native people. So now let's go back. That was a quick detour. So we got Egypt. Let's see if we can find a Egypt world map. We see Egypt. Looks like it's in Africa to me. So Israel and Egypt share a border. But if we remember in Genesis 15, the Most High promised Abraham from the Nile River over to the Euphrates. So he actually promised part of Egypt. I'm not sure how far down the ancient Nile went, but he did promise them from the Nile over to the Euphrates. So if we're using modern maps, and I know some of y'all believe it's in Africa, but if we're using the modern accepted locations, it would be at least a big chunk of Egypt in Africa, all the way across Arabia over to the Euphrates. So at least a chunk this big, maybe more, maybe even as much as this around the Arabian Peninsula. But yet they are here in this little sliver. I mean, here in this little sliver, even though they were promised all of this. So how could this little sliver, let me go back to their little sliver. How could this little sliver fulfill Bible prophecy when they were promised all of this, and at the very minimum, all of this? So something doesn't add up. So anyway, let's keep moving. Now, I want to address this one. I want to address something specific. I guess I'll leave it there. I want to address something specific because several people sent me this information. And I thought it was interesting, so I did look into it. And Queen Calafior or Calafia, I'm not sure how to pronounce it. People were saying that California was named after this Egyptian queen. And I thought that was interesting, so I decided to look it up, and it turns out it's actually not an Egyptian queen. But in the midst of that, I did find something interesting. Press 1 if you have heard of Queen Calafior or Calafia. Press 2 if you've never heard of her. I had never heard of her before people started mentioning after parts 1 and 2 of the United States of Egypt. So I learn from these just like you guys learn from these, because oftentimes people will come with a lot of information I didn't know. And I think that is one of the best parts of doing a channel like this, is because you don't know what you don't know. And so when people bring you new information, you get a chance to find out a bunch of stuff. So I probably learn at a faster rate than a lot of people that don't have channels, because I have so many people bombarding me with information. It's not just me. I mean, anybody with a channel that has experienced that, you get bombarded with information from all sorts of places. And so you have a chance to learn things before you put them out to the public. And then when the public sees it, they respond with even more information. So you get a chance to just, you know, learn at a crazy rate. It's been one of the most interesting things I've experienced in having this channel. So anyway, who was Queen Calafia? Published in Seville in 1510 before Europeans, and reached the northern Pacific coast, Las Sergas recounts the adventures of a knight named Esplandian, the son of Amadis, the hero of Montalvo's earlier novel. During an important junction in the novel, Esplandian has to help defend the city of Constantinople. Among those assaulting the city is a group of women warriors led by a queen named Calafia. Now, where else do we hear about the women warriors? The Dahomian Amazons. I'm not saying this is them, but it's probably loosely based on the Dahomian Amazons. Probably. See, a lot of Greek stories, like the Amazons, comes from Africa. Medusa was a Libyan queen, an African queen. So when you guys see movies like Attack of the Titans. Clash of the Titans. When you see movies like Clash of the Titans and they go to kill Medusa, they are traveling to Africa to kill Medusa. So here we have this group of female warriors, likely based on the Dahomian Amazons. So it says, those assaulting the city is a group of women warriors led by a queen named Calafia. Calafia rules over an island called, you guessed it, California. So this is from a book, a novel, a fictional book, in which Calafia, who is a queen, rules over California. And so when they found, use that word loosely with finger quotes, when they found California, or discovered what is now California, they named it California after this fictional place in a book. But here's what was interesting that I found. I tell you that on the right hand side of the Indies, there was an island called California, which was very close to the region of the earthly paradise. So assuming this is not talking, I haven't read the book, assuming it's not talking about a paradise in the book. Anyway, let me just not say that. The island was inhabited by black women, and there were no males among them at all. Sound like the Greek version of the Amazons? For their way of life was similar to that of the Amazons. The island was made up of the wildest cliffs and sharpest precipices found anywhere in the world. That's why I mentioned the Amazons. And again, the Dahomian Amazons are the most prevalent in my mind when we start talking about the Amazons. These women had energetic bodies and courageous, ardent hearts, and they were very strong. Their armor was made entirely out of gold, which was the only metal found on the island, as were the trappings of the fierce beasts that they rode on, that they rode once they were tamed. So, don't know what fierce beasts they were. I didn't read the book. In the novel, California is a fantastic place, filled with warrior women and fierce beasts. Of course, in Montalvo's story, someone as powerful as Calafia can't remain an enemy for long. She eventually switches loyalties, becomes Christian, and marries Esplandian's cousin. So wait, these black women were converted to Christians? So press one if you knew that California was named after a island of black women from a novel. Press two if you did not know that. I did not know that before being contacted saying that California was named after Calafia. So it wasn't that California was named after Queen Calafia. It's named after the kingdom of Queen Calafia in this novel, which happened to be an island full of black women. So let's keep looking. Right here you see some depictions of black women. Mural of Queen Calafia and her Amazon warriors at the Mark Hopkins Hotel in San Francisco by Maynard Dixon and Frank Von Sloan. First appearance, 1510. Gender, female, title, Queen Calafia, ruler of the island of California. Spouse, Talonque, nationality, Californian. Calafia, now this is Wikipedia. And I'm just reading this because I think these are interesting here. Calafia is the fictional queen of the island of California, first introduced by 16th century poet Garci Rodriguez de Montalvo in an epic novel of chivalry, Las Sagas de Esplandian, The Adventures of Esplandian, written around 1510. This is before slavery. Before the official date of 1619. A region of North America encompassing the U.S. state of California and the Mexican states of Baja California and Baja California Sur take their name from Calafia and her kingdom. In the novel, Calafia is a pagan warrior queen who ruled over a kingdom of black women living on the island of California, an island off the coast of Asia. Calafia is convinced to raise an army of women warriors and sail away from California with a large flock of trained griffins, so that she can join a Muslim battle against Christians who are defending Constantinople. In the siege, the griffins harm enemy and friendly forces, so they were withdrawn. Calafia and her ally, Rodario, fought in single combat against the Christian leaders, a king and his son, the knight Esplandian. Calafia is bested and taken prisoner, and she converts to Christianity. She marries the cousin of Esplandian and returns with her army to California for further adventures. But wait a minute. So this island of black women, the last source said fierce beasts. This specifically says griffins. What are griffins? The griffin, ancient Greek, late medieval Latin, is a legendary creature with the body, tail, and back legs of a lion, the head and wings of an eagle, and sometimes an eagle's talon as its front feet. Because the lion was traditionally considered king of the beasts and the eagle the king of the birds by the Middle Ages, the griffin was thought to be an especially powerful and majestic creature. Since classical antiquity, griffins were known for guarding treasures and priceless possessions. So the griffin basically looks like a hybrid creature. Why do we find so many hybrids in these stories? So it was an island of black women warriors that rode on griffins. And the griffins attacked everybody, not just the enemy. So, yeah, I'm just showing you guys here. These griffins appear where the last one was a Roman griffin. Griffin sergeant wearing a mural crown of Perugia, 13th century. So the griffins appear throughout history. These hybrid creatures that had wings and the body of a lion. And you see different versions of the griffin. Looks like something that shouldn't exist. I don't know what this cow part is, but yeah, you'll see them depicted differently. But yeah. Apparently, people all over the world were familiar with these creatures. And we see the griffins here. So if you guys pay attention, you guys will see griffins all over. And I'm talking about throughout history. You'll see these. You'll see them on buildings. You'll see statues of griffins everywhere. These strange hybrid creatures. And apparently these black women had enough of them to keep as either guardians or pets, or maybe they lived on that island. I don't know. But the story, again, it's a novel, it's not real, said that they rode griffins into battle. And I think it's interesting that we find so many components of Greek mythology associated with Africa or black people. As I mentioned, Medusa was a Libyan queen. So we have that bit of mythology there. We have the Amazons, based probably on the Dahomian Amazons, and now we see griffins in California in the story, ridden by a nation of black women. So anyway, let's keep going. I just find this stuff to be very interesting that we find so many of these connections. All right, so now there's a fake Egyptian city buried in California. This is a movie set, but I think it's interesting that it just, a recent movie set too, recent history. The incredibly nearly forgotten story behind one of Hollywood's most expensive movie sets. This is 2015. Let's say, buried in the sands of California lay an 800-foot-long temple, 35-foot-tall statues of Ramses II, and a promenade guarded by 5-ton sphinxes. This lost metropolis isn't a bizarre Egyptian colony, though. The ruins are all the remains of Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments set, one of the largest and most expensive Hollywood history expensive in Hollywood history, reports David Ferry for Outside. In that pre-computer generated effects era, an epic film needed a truly epic set. So basically, they made the Ten Commandments. Let's see. DeMille filmed the Ten Commandments north of Santa Barbara along the Guadalupe Nipomo Dunes, Ferry writes. When filming ended, the already pricey production couldn't afford to dismantle and transport the set, nor did DeMille want to leave it standing, since another filmmaker could swoop in to use it on the cheap. As legend has it, the director chose instead to dynamite and bulldoze the whole thing. So he just didn't want somebody else to use this set, so he destroyed it. So anyway, there's an Egyptian, an replica Egyptian city buried in California. I just thought that was an interesting one. That doesn't really prove anything, but I think it's just interesting, all this stuff here. Now, this one right here, some of you guys might enjoy. New York Statue of Liberty was meant to be a Muslim woman guarding the Suez Canal. This is from Enterprise State of the Nation. Oh, the Statue of Liberty. This is some interesting stuff here. America's most iconic symbol was originally meant to be a Muslim woman guarding the newly opened Suez Canal. The first sketch of New York Statue of Liberty by architect Frederick August Bartholdi was first intended to represent an Egyptian peasant in Muslim garments. In his early design, Bartholdi called the sculpture Egypt carrying the light to Asia. However, Egyptian officials rejected the statue as too expensive, leading the architect to take his plans to America. He had to drop her Islamic robe and transform her into a Roman goddess, renaming her Liberty, enlightening the world. The statue has guarded New York's harbor since 1886. Watch a brief on the history of this very American story here. So, the Statue of Liberty was originally presented to Egypt, and it was originally intended to represent an Egyptian peasant in Muslim garments. Press 1 if you knew the Statue of Liberty was originally an Egyptian woman. Press 2 if you did not know that. I did not know that. I had heard, about it being gifted to America. And then I went and dug into this. Somebody mentioned it in the comments. So I went and dug into this and found out the Statue of Liberty was indeed meant to be an Egyptian woman originally. Again, press 1 if you knew that. Press 2 if you did not know that. So the Statue of Liberty was originally an Egyptian woman gifted to America in 1881. Let me back up. 1886. There we go. So now we have the Statue of Liberty, a big old idol. They changed it to a Roman goddess. So now you have elements of Rome. We're going to get into some more of that stuff about, the ongoing Roman Empire, the Greco-Roman Empire, how it split up, who became who and who ended up founding America. We'll get more into that in a later study, but yeah, the Statue of Liberty, an Egyptian woman in Muslim clothes. So they changed it to a Roman goddess. But let's read a little bit more. This is from the Smithsonian mag.com. All these links will be in the description. Let me close this. The Statue of Liberty was originally a Muslim woman. The new Colossus was actually born in Egypt. This is not an Israelite. This is from the Smithsonian. The United States has debated immigration since the country's founding, and the Statue of Liberty, a potent symbol for immigrants, is often invoked as an argument for why we should usher in those who seek safety and opportunity with open arms. A little known fact about Lady Liberty adds an intriguing twist to today's debate about refugees from the Muslim world. As pointed out by the Daily Beast, Michael Daly, or Daly, in a recent op-ed, the statue itself was originally intended to represent a female Egyptian peasant as a Colossus of Rhodes for the Industrial Age. That might be surprising to people more familiar with the statue's French roots than its Arab ones. After all, the statue's structure was designed by Alexander Gustav Eiffel. Yes, that Eiffel. Same guy did the Eiffel Tower. And Lady Liberty was given to the United States by France for its centennial to celebrate the alliance of the two countries formed during the French Revolution. So yeah, and we'll come down right here. It mentions it again. Now let's see. The statue's designer, Frederick Auguste Bartholdi, was also French, but he found inspiration in a very different place, Egypt. In 1855, he visited Nubian monuments at Abu Simbel, which featured tombs guarded by gigantic colossus figures. Bartholdi became fascinated by the ancient architecture, Egyptomania, developing what the National Park Service calls a passion for large-scale public monuments and colossal structures. Eventually, he channeled that passion into a proposal for the inauguration of the Suez Canal. Bartholdi envisioned a colossal monument featuring a robe-clad woman representing Egypt to stand at port, said the city at the northern terminus of the Canal of Egypt. Port Said, the city at the northern terminus of the canal in Egypt. That's a weird name to name a port. All right, to prep for this undertaking, Barry Moreno, author of multiple books about the statue, writes that Bartholdi studied art like the Colossus, honing the concept for a figure called Libertas who would stand at the canal, taking the form of a veiled peasant woman, writes Moreno. And the statue was to stand 86 feet high, and its pedestal was to rise at a height of 48 feet. Early models of the statue were called Egypt Carrying the Light to Asia. So we keep seeing that coming up. So we know the Statue of Liberty has an Egyptian origin. Edward Berenson, or Egyptian inspiration. Edward Berenson, author of The Statue of Liberty, A Transatlantic Story, interesting, writes that Bartholdi's concept more from a gigantic female fella or Arab peasant. So if you ever heard the word fella, that's where it comes from. Arab peasant. So if somebody calls you little fella or big fella or any kind of fella, they are calling you an Arab peasant into a colossal goddess. But Egypt, which had invested enormous amounts of time and money into the landmark canal, was not as eager about Bartholdi's idea. Ismail Pasha, the reigning Khedive, rejected the plan as too costly. Eventually, a 180-foot tall lighthouse was installed at Port Said instead, but Bartholdi was not discouraged. He eventually repurposed his concept into Liberty Enlightening the World, the official name for the statue that has been overlooking New York Harbor since 1886. All this stuff points to America and Egypt, and yet we're crazy for looking at the text and saying, wait a minute, they were told that they would be put into slavery worldwide and they would be taken back to Egypt in ships. And then we look at history, we see a group of people taken to a place that is clearly trying to associate itself with Egypt, and they're taken in ships and turned into slaves. Egypt enslaved Israel and forced Israel to build treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. This is in the book. What happened here? Our ancestors were forced to build this nation for free, making it one of the richest nations, basically a treasure nation. Egypt had treasure cities. America was a treasure nation built on the backs of Israelites, not African Americans. They didn't go over and kidnap African Americans. They kidnapped Israelites. And I'm going to back that statement up in a second. For those of you who have never heard it, I'm going to back it up in a second. The Statue of Liberty and its ties to the Middle East. We're just going to read this real quick, and then we're going to move on. I'm not going to read the whole thing. You guys can read this later. The Oriental Institute of the University of Chicago. Links will be in the description. The fragmentary nature of Don Vo's We the People echoes the often shattered sculpture that archaeologists recover and attempt to reconstruct. Pieces of a single ancient statue may be dispersed across different museums, just as Vo's work is being shown at venues all over the world. Its placement at the Oriental Institute also serves as a reminder of the power of imperial monumental art from the distant past to the modern era. These some pictures real quick before I read the rest of this. Left the modern reconstruction of the Colossus of Rhodes, built 292 to 280 BC. Right, Egypt or Progress, Carrying the Light to Asia by Frederick August Bartholdi. This early version of the Statue of Liberty was never built. Images courtesy of Saudi Aramco World Magazine. So you have the Colossus of Rhodes, Statue of Liberty. Well, before known as Egypt Carrying Light to Asia. All right. Now an iconic American monument, the Statue of Liberty has interesting connections to the ancient world and the modern history of the Middle East. Its sculptor, Frederick August Bartholdi, visited Egypt in 1855 and expressed his admiration for the colossal statues on the facade of the temple at Abu Simbel. He resolved to work on a monumental scale, and in 1867, Bartholdi proposed that the Egyptian government build a giant statue and light beacon in the form of a woman holding a torch aloft to be erected at the entrance of the Suez Canal, entitled Egypt or Progress, Carrying the Light to Asia. It was to symbolize industrial and social progress in Egypt. The Suez statue was never built, and the project was later reconfigured as a gift from France to the United States to celebrate the centennial of American independence, dedicated in New York, 1886. In its final form, Bartholdi's Statue of Liberty harkens back strongly to reconstructions of the Colossus of Rhodes, one of the original seven wonders of the ancient world. So yeah, now you guys see that there is a connection between the Statue of Liberty and Egypt. So if we just take a glance at America from a historical perspective, and we try to associate America with any ancient culture, based on what we found, we would have to associate it with Egypt just by the architecture, the founding in Freemasonry, what that links back to, the Washington Monument. We have the pyramids, the names of the cities. We have tourist attractions. We have the Statue of Liberty. But let's look at a couple more, and then we're just going to wrap this up. So you have the Oregon Trail obelisk. This is 2004. These men built a bunch of obelisks along the Oregon Trail. We're not going to read all this, but we'll just read, you know, this little part right here. Boise. Two Boise residents' passion for neighborhood history landed new Oregon Trail obelisk in the North End, marking the tail end of a decade-long project. Mark Baltz, a public artist who lives in the North End, and Glenn Corbeil, a union electrician who lives in South Boise Village, worked to place many of the 17 steel Oregon Trail obelisks along Boise Avenue and in the North End. It takes a couple of muscles and a whole lot of willpower, Corbeil said. It's more of a mental thing. So basically, these guys started building obelisks because Egyptomania is still a real thing. So right here, let's see. We have better pictures of the obelisk. So we have this one right here. We got this obelisk right here. These people are obsessed with Egyptian culture. They got obelisks everywhere. Obsessed with Egyptian culture. So yeah, there are obelisks all over the place in the United States. Alrighty. Let's show a couple more of these. If you guys look around, you will see all the Egyptian stuff that is placed all over this country, and yet we're not supposed to associate America with Egypt in any way. There's no possible way America could be Egypt. This is what we're told. 123 historical obelisks around the world. So these aren't all in America, but we just see all kind of stuff happening in America. Let's see here. Oregon, another obelisk right there. Pretty sure we looked at that one a second ago. This is Santa Fe, New Mexico. Yeah, so anyway, as you guys can see, there's a bunch of obelisks all over the United States. Let's see, here's another one. All right, so let's look at some of this, and then we're going to get into some scripture, and then we're gonna wrap this up, this trilogy. So what I did was I looked for cities, U.S. cities with Egyptian names, and it pulled up. This is one of the results, cassavafilms.com, 9 non-English origins of U.S. city names. This one only has a couple, so Egyptian. It says, now things are getting interesting, since it's not like Egyptian explorers have ever sailed their boats to the U.S. That's arguable. If you guys look into some of the artifacts found in the Grand Canyon, some believe they're real, some believe they're fake. I'll leave that to you to decide. But many people believe that Egyptians did sail to the U.S. long before Columbus, Leif Erikson, or any of them. You know, all the Europeans, they give credit for finding a full continent with people already occupying. All right. The city of Memphis, which we talked about, Memphis, has purely romantic origins. Andrew Jackson named it after the ancient Egyptian capital because of its location on the Nile-like Mississippi. And we went over that, the Nile and I believe the Kansas River being compared to the Mississippi. Alexandria, Virginia, and Little Cairo, Illinois, though the locals pronounce it Cairo, are the other Egyptian-derived towns. So we're not going to get into the Greek or any of that stuff right now. But we have Alexandria, we have Little Cairo, we have Mississippi being compared to the Nile, and let me see here, and Memphis. And there's a pyramid in Memphis. You guys saw that in part two, I believe it was. So now Wikipedia gives us a little bit, you know, more, not much, but a little bit. So we have Cairo, Illinois, Cairo, Ohio, Cairo, Georgia. We have Luxor, Pennsylvania, Memphis, Tennessee, Memphis, Indiana, and Suez Township, Illinois, because the Suez Canal is under control of Egypt in Africa. So these are more town names associated with Egypt. So now let's get back to why this was important to find out whether or not America has any association with Egypt. And it all links back to the Exodus. It all links back to Moses. It all links back to the Moabite covenant, or the Moab covenant, found in Deuteronomy 28, 29, 30, and 31. Those chapters right there covering what happened if Israel obeyed versus disobeyed, the blessings and the curses, when these curses would take place, and as Moses says in the latter days in Deuteronomy 31, I believe. So now, the slavery in Egypt, in my opinion, was probably very similar to what happened here in America. So now, we'll read some of Exodus 1. We're not going to read the whole thing. We'll start at verse 6, Exodus chapter 1, verse 6. And we'll talk about a few things in here. And Joseph died, and all his brethren, and all that generation. And the children of Israel were fruitful and increasingly abundant and multiplied and waxed exceeding mighty. And the land was filled with them. Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. And he said unto his people, behold, the people of the children of Israel are more and mightier than we. Come on, let us deal wisely with them. Wasn't wise how they dealt with them at all, lest they multiply and it come to pass that when there falleth out any war, they join also unto our enemies and fight against us, and so get them up out of the land. Now, they have been living side by side in harmony with Egyptians up to this point, as far as we know. And yet this new king thought they would rise and fight him. Why? Some people believe that this king was a different king, a non-Egyptian invader. Tao Ministries has covered it, and a few other people have covered it as well. I would encourage you guys to do some research on who this king was. Many people do not believe he was an Egyptian. And so this is why they believe that Israel might join in fall or in war against them. Therefore, they did set over them taskmasters or overseers to afflict them with their burdens, and they built for Pharaoh treasure cities, Pithom and Ramses. Again, same thing they did in slavery to our ancestors, forced them to build this nation into a treasure nation, inventions and structure and infrastructure and all of that stuff. Is the reason America became the superpower it is, because it got 400 plus years of free labor. But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew, and they were grieved because of the children of Israel. Look at the situation in America. The Egyptians made the children of Israel serve with rigor. It was probably a form of chattel slavery, early form of chattel slavery like here in America. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage in mortar and in brick and in all manner of service in the field. Israel worked the field, just like here in America. All their service wherein they made them serve was with rigor. So this was a harsh bondage. If you guys don't know anything about American bondage, sometimes they were working 18 plus hours a day and got one day off a week. Harsh bondage, but they don't want us to associate this with what happened in the Exodus. I will send you to Egypt again, this time with ships. And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of one was Shiphrah, and the name of the other Puah. And he said, when ye do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stools, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. Why? Because the men are the backbone of the society. I know women like to think they're equal, but they're not physically equal to a man. And the men are the protectors of the society. So what you will see is, as far back as the Exodus in the Bible, they start to attack the males. If you kill off the males, the women can't reproduce. Why? Because if you let one male live and 100 women live, that male could impregnate those 100 women. But if there's one woman and 100 men, she can only have babies so fast. And if she has all boys, they're all done. They're wiped out. So they kill off the male line. They attack the males. What do? They want the males killed. And Moses ends up getting put in the river. But they kill off the males. Or in the case of America, they imprison the males. They paid black leadership in the churches to push the 94 crime bill, and they paid the black leadership in political positions to push the 94 crime bill. And then when it disproportionately locked up all the black men, which took them out of the homes, they said, oops, our bad, we made a mistake. And what did black people keep doing? They kept voting Democrat. And then when 96 came around and the Democrats pushed welfare reform, where they couldn't have a man in the house to get as much money as needed to take care of their families, and the man can't get a job because he now has a criminal record because of what they did in 94, it tears apart the black home. And so now you see 70%+ of black homes don't have a father in it. There was a systematic reason for that. It's not just because black men are abandoning their children. There were systematic reasons. There was bribery. There was all kind of stuff. And then you see the police killing black men. So either they're in jail, they're dead, or they're kicked out of the home based on a system of bribery, so that the family can either take care of the kids or they can't. If you want to take care of your kids, get that black man out the house. We'll give you some money. So we see that this attack on males happens. It happens in the Bible multiple times. When they want to stop the Messiah, what do? They kill the males. So anyway, and he said, when you do the office of midwife to the Hebrew women and you see them upon the stools, if it be a son, then you shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. We're not going to get into abortion right now. How abortion is pushed in the black community and was pushed through the black churches. These black churches that talk about how much they've done for our community, they always neglect to mention that Margaret Sanger used the black church to push abortion on the community, which again kills off children, not just males, but males and females, kills off a large portion of black, the black community every year. And they pitch that as women's rights. And of course, here come the Democrats pushing that stuff. And of course, they push the LGBTQ stuff. We're not even going to get into all that right now. But understand, it's all systematic attacks on the black family. And he said, I read that already, but the midwives feared God and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the men children alive. And the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said unto them, why have ye done this thing and have saved the men children alive? And the midwives said unto Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are lively and are delivered ere or before the midwives come in unto them. They're lying. Therefore God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and waxed very mighty. And it came to pass, because the midwives feared God, that he made them houses. And the Pharaoh charged all his people, saying, every son that is born ye shall cast into the river, and every daughter ye shall save alive. So now Pharaoh is telling his own people, because when the men are there, the nation becomes stronger. That's why you see such an effort in Hollywood and other places to feminize the black man, to make it okay for the black man to be gay, for feminism to say that black women don't need a man, for welfare to bribe black women to get rid of the man. There is a systematic, it's systematically in the justice system, they want to put the black man in prison to keep the black men away from the black community. So this attack on the black man is happening from all corners. And I know people like to say, well, nobody has it harder than the black woman. Not true, because you guys can go and get resources if there's no black man in the house. Black men can't just go get resources readily available, because nobody cares about a man, an able-bodied man that is struggling, especially an able-bodied black man. I even feel a certain way when I see able-bodied men asking for money, and they don't have like a bucket to wash some windows or clean some tires or, you know, something, anything. I feel a certain way about it. So understand that there's very few resources a black man can just go get if he's not working. But if a black woman is struggling, she can go get resources from the government. So there is more of an is literal attack on black men. There's an attack on the black community as a whole, but black men specifically are being targeted and have been targeted since the days of Egypt. Let's keep going. Now, here's what I believe they are afraid of. Why they're afraid of us recognizing that we are Israel, us recognizing that this is Egypt, because there were promises made, promises that our ancestors would go into slavery and be scattered worldwide via slavery if they disobeyed. God carried out his part of the bargain. He says, but if you remember me and repent and turn back to me, I will remember the covenant. And I will deliver you from the land of your captivity and destroy your enemies. I'm paraphrasing. And so they don't want that to happen, because what happened in Egypt? It says, and Moses was content to dwell with the man, and he gave Moses Zipporah his daughter. This is after Moses left. And she bare him a son and called his name Gershom, for he said, I have been a stranger in a strange land. Now, I'm going to stop for a second and talk about this word stranger. Moses is calling himself a stranger among the Midianites. So later on, when Israel is given commands and it's about strangers, it's not about Israelites. That word stranger is not referring to Israelites. People like to make the Bible all Israelite so they can say that nobody else gets salvation. But right here, the word stranger is used in context of Moses being from another people coming over to Midian. So in context, the word stranger, when referenced from another people coming over to Israel, would not be Israelites coming back to Israel. Don't be deceived by these people out here who are using hate to try to say that it's Israel only salvation. It's not. And it came to pass in the process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage. And they cried, and their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage. And God heard their groaning. This is what they don't want. That's why they want us to shut up. Shut up about the slavery. Keep it down. Don't say nothing. We don't want God to hear. Don't say nothing about the lynchings. Don't say nothing about anything else that's going wrong. The justice system, the wrongful incarceration, the over-policing. Keep your voices down. Don't say nothing. Just forgive and forget. You got to move on. You're stuck in the past. All this stuff to silence the voices. Because they don't want God to hear. And God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them. Now we've gone through the prayers of Solomon and some of the other stuff that Daniel and Nehemiah and Baruch referenced. That when Israel would cry to God, God would hear them and acknowledge them and move on their behalf. They don't want that to happen again. Let's keep going real quick. Right here. He says, and I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go. No, not by a mighty hand. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that, he will let you go. And I will give this people favor in the sight of the Egyptians, and it shall come to pass that when ye shall not go empty. But every woman shall borrow of her neighbor and of her that sojourneth in her house, jewels of silver and jewels of gold and raiment, and ye shall put them upon your sons and upon your daughters, and ye shall spoil the Egyptians. So we have a pattern here. Israel goes into harsh bondage. Israel cries out to the Most High. The Most High hears. The Most High is going to get all his people together. I'm going to show you guys something in a second. Because a lot of the opposition says there's no way that God would wake up Israel to their identity. He wouldn't wake you up to your identity. See, they're putting God in their box based on their human understanding. And so now they're trying to philosophize and theologize. I don't even know if these are words. They're probably not. They're words because I said them. But they try to philosophize and theologize their way into an understanding of God. And then you hear the jealousy in some of them. Well, why didn't God tell me? Well, maybe you're not Israel. I never said that all black people in America or Israel, I believe the majority. I don't believe that everybody there. And I've said that before because there were strangers there with Israel that made that covenant in Deuteronomy 29 that accepted the rules of the covenant. It wasn't just Israel. And so I don't believe 100% of the people that came over in the transatlantic slave trade were Israelites. I know some people do believe that, but I don't believe that. And so what's happening is some of these people are jealous that Israel is being waken up and God isn't talking to them or moving through them. Why? Because they are not the people that he wants to use. God will choose whoever he wants to. And for whatever reason, he doesn't choose them. But for some reason, they think they're entitled to being used by God. They think they're entitled. Well, if God's going to move through anybody, he would move through me. Maybe, maybe not. A lot of these people are useless to the Most High in the sense of spreading his word. And so instead of moving out of the way, they want to oppose something because they feel entitled to being used by God. And if God ain't using them, he definitely ain't using those other people over there. This is how they think. If God's not using me, he definitely ain't using them. And so if he's not using me, he's definitely not using them. And that means that whatever they're doing is not of God. This is how these people think. So let's move on a little bit. And the Lord said to Aaron, go into the wilderness to meet Moses. And he went and met him in the mount of God and kissed him. So this is after Moses' protest. But this is what I was talking about, God gathering his people. And Moses told Aaron all the words of the Lord who had sent him and all the signs which he had commanded him. So now Moses, God speaks to Moses. Then God speaks to Aaron. They meet up. Now Moses is telling Aaron what happened. And Moses and Aaron went and gathered together all the elders of the children of Israel. So wait, they're spreading that. Hey, God is moving. God is moving. God is about to do something. God is saying something. God told me a thing. So this is how it starts. And Moses and Aaron went and gathered together all the elders of the children of Israel. And Aaron spake all the words which the Lord had spoken unto Moses, and did the signs in the sight of the people. And the people believed. And when they heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel, and that he had looked upon their affliction, then they bowed their heads and worshiped. What's happening among those being awakened to who we are as a people? We're turning back to the Most High and saying, you know, we want nothing to do with that other organization over there in their buildings. We want everything to do with the book. We just don't want their doctrine. We don't want their building. We don't want their practices. We don't want their theology. We don't want their lack of education. We don't want their ignorance. We don't believe that you can do as thou wilt. We don't want anything to do with what they're teaching over there. And so we're turning back to the Most High, and they're mad about that because they have lost control. They can no longer control us. They can no longer mentally brainwash us. And so people are walking away from their buildings, not the body of Christ. They're walking away from their buildings, which means those buildings are losing money and they're closing up. If they were called in the first place, they'll find a way. God didn't tell us to go sit in no building. He said, go ye therefore and teach all nations. He didn't say, go get a 501c3, sit in a building, pay rent, and wait for people to come to you. You can't point to me one church on a corner that by sitting there is fulfilling the Great Commission, unless they have an evangelist team, an outreach team, to go out and reach out to people. If they're not going out in the neighborhoods, they're just sitting in the church building waiting for people to come to them, they are not fulfilling the Great Commission. And I'm not getting into what was added later and all that other stuff. We're not even going to do that right now. But they are not fulfilling the Great Commission. And they wonder why they're being shut down and why God isn't using them. They want to sit in place. They could get on the internet and reach people, but when you see them get on the internet, they can't draw a crowd. They can't get people to listen. So what do? They cop out and say, oh, well, I'm not in it for the views. But wait, he said, go ye therefore and teach all nations. Now you're not in it for the views, the listeners, to reach as many people as you can. That's ignorant. Why even get online if you're not in it for the views? There's no reason to get online. Sit in your house, yell at your TV screen, yell at your computer screen. Do what y'all do in those buildings. Sit there and wait for people to come to y'all. But see, they get online for the views and they can't get the views. The reason they can't get the views is because maybe they're not called. I'm just saying. So Moses and Aaron gather the people together. And so now that the people know God is going to make a move, and now remember, Israel's still rebellious. They can see all this stuff and still turn on God. They know God is about to make a move. And so when we get to chapter 5, after Moses and Aaron start going to Pharaoh, what happens? Their bondage becomes more harsh. The treatment becomes worse. So what's happening now that Israel is saying, hey, look, we're Israel. This stuff is pointing to us, and we're going to be redeemed soon by the Most High because we're important to him. We have people who look like us mad at us saying that God is going to deliver us. They're mad at us saying that God chose us as a nation. They were fine when those Europeans, the 1948 people, were saying it. They didn't have a problem with any of the Hebrew roots groups who had members that were saying it. So whenever Europeans say it, it's okay. They didn't have any problems with any of the movies being put out, and you have a predominantly European cast playing nothing but Africans. That's fine. But as soon as a black person says, no, that's historically inaccurate, we can show you with a map that that's in Africa. Oh, well, it doesn't matter. Your identity's in Christ. You're making it about skin color. You're idolizing your ethnicity. You're putting your culture over Christ. Wait a minute. How come those other people didn't get that reaction when they wrote a letter saying we need some land? And then the other people said, OK, we'll get you that land. We'll go in there and bomb people and murder people. We will take that land and make sure you hold that land. And then we'll have more Europeans from America send you money because we're going to say that you're the chosen people. So they took land and murdered people and got a bunch of money based off of ethnic claims using the Bible. Something Israelites did not do, and somehow they got all the smoke for us, but nothing to say to those other people over there murdering and taking land. You can see the hypocrisy moving through the church in general, the buildings, but more specifically in the black church buildings, there's a hatred for black people, a demonic level hatred for black people to say they're Israel. Doesn't matter what you believe. As soon as you say you're Israel, you're a pariah. You're chasing the flesh. But if you say you're African American, that's cool. That's not fleshly. If you celebrate Black History Month, when it's all about color and culture and race, that's fine. But don't say you're an Israelite. If you see any of these anti-Israelites out there celebrating Black History Month, they are celebrating a skin doctrine. They are putting their culture over Christ. They are chasing their ethnicity. They are puffed up, high-minded, you know, all the stuff they say about us. That's what they are if they ever celebrate Black History Month again, ever, in any capacity. So we see the hypocrisy coming out. But let me go ahead and read this. It says, let their more work be laid upon the men, that they may labor therein, and let them not regard vain words, useless words. And the taskmasters of the people went out, and their officers, and they spake to the people, saying, thus saith Pharaoh, I will not give you straw. Remember what happened to Moses? He became a fugitive because he murdered an officer, a taskmaster. And so he was a fugitive, and it took him this long to get back. Go ye, get you straw where you can find it, yet not aught of your work shall be diminished. So now they have to do extra work and still meet the same quota. So the people were scattered abroad throughout all the land of Egypt to gather stubble instead of straw. And the taskmasters hasted them, saying, fulfill your works, your daily task, as when there was straw. And the officers of the children of Israel, which Pharaoh's taskmasters had set over them, were beaten and demanded, wherefore have ye not fulfilled your task in making bricks, both yesterday and today as heretofore? Do some research on slavery. What happened if they didn't complete what they were supposed to do? They would get beat. Same as in Egypt. But they don't want us to make the comparison. And if you guys go follow the Beyond Deuteronomy 28 series and some of the other studies I put on there, when I get into some of the slave rebellions, many of the slave rebellions are linked to slaves getting their hands on the Bible. They get their hands on the Bible and say, wait a minute, we're Israel, and they rebel. They are afraid of something. This is what they fought to keep our ancestors away from, the entire book. Because every time black people get their hands on the entire book, something happens. Then the officers of the children of Israel came up and cried unto Pharaoh, saying, wherefore dealest thou thus with thy servants? There is no straw given unto thy servants. And they say to us, make brick, and behold, thy servants are beaten, but the fault is in thine own people. But he said, ye are idle, ye are idle. Therefore ye say, let us go and do sacrifice to the Lord. So they feel the solution to Israel turning back to God is beating Israel and putting more work on them. But what's interesting here is they get mad at Israel for wanting to serve God. We see that now in many of the people who call themselves Christian. Israel wants to turn back to the book and serve God. And so they are mad. And when the people whose fault it was blamed, what did they say? You're idle. Or lazy. What did they call them? Lazy. What do we see happening to black people? Black people are called lazy, even though we're the ones that built this country. We're some of the hardest working people in this country, and yet they call black people lazy when they were sitting around doing nothing. They weren't inventing. They weren't contributing. All they were doing was stealing people's culture. The reason Europeans became so powerful is because they stole gunpowder from the Chinese. Learn the history. They stole culture. This is what they were good at. Other people invented and made stuff and built stuff. Europeans were good at stealing stuff. All right. Go therefore now and work, for there shall no straw be given you, yet shall ye deliver the tale of bricks. And the officers of the children of Israel did see that they were in an evil case. Evil case, after it was said, ye shall not diminish aught from your bricks of your daily task. So they knew something evil was happening, and they had no choice but to call out to the Most High. Look at the situation in America. No matter what they do, you will always find some of our people who will defend it and are against us. And we know the other people aren't going to do anything. Just look at Joe Biden. He's not going to do anything for black people. Kamala, whatever you call her, Harris, she ain't going to do nothing for black people. She said that and laughed about it. And some of our ignorant people still voted for her. They act like voting for one of these parties is going to change anything. And it doesn't. And especially the Democrat Party, they've been the enemy of black people since the beginning. No, there was no party switch. That is a myth. Go look into Southern Strategy if you're still being lied to and fed that myth of a party switch. That's a Democrat lie. The reason the Republican Party became as racist as it is now is because they used Southern Strategy to attract Democrats to the party. So the Democrats came over to the party and made the party anti-black, but not all the Democrats came over. Many of the Democrats stayed. So you ended up with two racist parties. You had Democrat 1.0 and Democrat 2.0, in which they mixed in with the Republican Party. That's historical fact. It's not the fiction of, well, the party switched in, the Democrats started to like black people. No, the Democrats hated black people before Jim Crow, and the Democrats used the 94 crime bill to enslave black people after Jim Crow in the modern system. So when you see some of these black people who were hollering about prison reform and justice system reform before the Democrats got in office, ask them why they're not talking about it now. See, they shut up when Democrats get in office. They all of a sudden don't want reform. But when Republicans get in office, then they want prison reform, because they don't want to draw attention to the fact that the Democrats are the reason we need prison reform. And the Democrats don't want to change it, so they won't change it. And that's why they haven't changed it since 94. People act like they passed it in 94 and it went away. No, it did not go away. It's still intact. It's still doing what it's meant to do, locking up black men at a disproportional rate. But until our people figure out the Democrats are not our friend, Republicans are not our friend, this stuff is going to continue. Now, the historical fact is Republicans have been more friendly to our community, but they are not our friend. Democrats have never been friendly to us, and yet for some reason our people just keep voting for them. They are stuck in this denial of reality. You can go look at the Democrat policies on paper, see what they do to the black community, and our people will still pretend like it's not there. Same thing that's going on with us being Israel. We can put out as much information as we want to, but when a person insists on being in their ignorance because they're in their emotions about the parties and they don't want to see the evidence, they do like the black Christians do, the ones that sit in the church buildings that are falling apart and losing members. They just stick their head in the sand like an ostrich and say, nope, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to see it. I'm not going to look at no sources. I'm just going to continue to believe what I believe, even if it's false. So now, and they met Moses and Aaron, who stood in the way as they came forth from Pharaoh. And they said unto them, the Lord look upon you and judge, because ye have made our savor to be abhorred in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of his servants, to put a sword in their hand to slay us. And Moses returned unto the Lord and said, Lord, wherefore, why hast thou so in evil treated this people? Why is it that thou hast sent me? I've gone over before that one of the signs was when people shall ask, why did this happen? Or why did slavery happen? Or why did Israel get scattered? All these questions, when people ask, say, because they disobeyed the Lord and broke his commandments. For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in thy name, he had done evil to this people, neither hast thou delivered thy people at all. You haven't done what you said you're going to do. I encourage you to read the entire book of Exodus and see how the people were treated. I just wanted to give you a quick summary of how the people were treated in the book of Exodus, because they complained about their treatment. Think about that for a second. Whenever black people start to complain about our treatment, look at how we're treated. Look at how we're treated by the media. Look at how we're treated by the politicians. Look at how we're treated by our own. They want to label it as critical race theory to tell the truth about Europeans. And you have a lot of these Negropeans out there who support this nonsense. They don't want to talk about history. They don't want to talk about how it's affected everything. They don't want to talk about that Jim Crow laws were abolished within the lifetime of a single person. Many people right now have family members living on this planet alive right now that were born under Jim Crow laws. My mom was born 1 year before the Jim Crow laws were abolished, before the Civil Rights Act. 1 year before the Civil Rights Act. So there are people living on this planet right now born under Jim Crow, but they want you to think this stuff was so long ago. They want you to concentrate on slavery, but they don't want to concentrate on the gap between slavery and where we are now. Some of your parents and grandparents living alive right now lived in that gap between slavery and where we are now, where you had the lynchings, where you had the Jim Crow, you had the sundown towns. Do some research into our history. This was not that long ago. This was within the lifetime of a single person, and anybody born before 1965 was born under Jim Crow. I believe 1964 technically, but let's just say anybody born before 1964 lived under Jim Crow laws. I'm just saying, know your history. So when they try to feed you this nonsense, you can look at it and say, you know what? Something you're saying doesn't make sense. So now, why did I read you the Exodus stuff? Because this right here, the slavery that we, our ancestors were brought in, the land of our captivity that we live in now, it's part of a bigger picture. See, the transatlantic slave trade was huge. It was the first worldwide slavery. Egypt was localized, but the slavery prophesied in Deuteronomy 28 was worldwide slavery. And so Egypt was a big event that we still talk about today. However, we know certain things have not been fulfilled because Jeremiah would be a liar. It's either Jeremiah the Most High. Jeremiah claims to have heard from God, and Jeremiah is a prophet. So if this thing doesn't get fulfilled, it means Jeremiah was a false prophet, which means he was not hearing from God, which means we need to take the whole book of Jeremiah out of the Bible. Now, I'm going to ask you a question after I read through some of this. It says, therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord. We're going to stop right there. So this is God talking. So either Jeremiah is telling the truth, or Jeremiah is a liar, or Jeremiah heard from something else other than God that intended to lie to him. So the days are coming. So if it's from God, we can rely on this to happen. That it shall no more be said, the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. So whatever's about to happen, it's going to overshadow the Egyptian Exodus. But the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north and from all the lands whither they had driven them. And I will bring them again into their land that I gave unto their fathers. People are trying to say that's the 1948 people, but no, that's not the event. We know there's some inconsistencies and people are still talking about Egypt. This is going to be an undeniable event. It says, behold, I will send for many fishers, saith the Lord, and they shall fish them. And after I will send for many hunters, and they shall hunt them from every mountain and from every hill and out of the holes of the rocks. For mine eyes are upon all their ways, and they are not hid from my face, neither is their iniquity hid from mine eyes. And first I will recompense their iniquity and their sin double, because they have defiled my land. They have filled my inheritance with the carcasses of their detestable and abominable things. Now you guys can go through and read. I'll just read all this. O Lord, my strength and my fortress and my refuge, in the day of affliction, the Gentiles shall come unto thee from the ends of the earth and shall say, surely our fathers have inherited lies, vanity, and things wherein there is no profit. Who? The Gentiles. Hold on, I'm going to take you back to Gentiles in a second. Shall a man make gods unto himself, and they are no gods? Therefore, behold, I will this once cause them to know, and I will cause them to know mine hand and my might, and they shall know that my name is the Lord. So now, the Gentiles shall come from the ends of the earth and shall say, surely our fathers have inherited lies, vanity, and things wherein there's no profit. All right, so the Gentiles, had to do a quick pause there and get everything pulled up because I hadn't prepared to go into this. The Gentiles shall come unto thee from the ends of the earth and shall say, surely our fathers have inherited lies, vanity, and things wherein there is no profit. Why specifically would the Gentiles come to the Lord from the end of the earth? Why would the Gentiles come? So let's go over here. Remember, Jerusalem's going to be trodden down to the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. And if we come back to Genesis 10:3, we're always going to come back to this. The sons of Gomer, Ashkenaz, and Ripheth, and Togarmah, Ashkenaz. Who are the Ashkenazi descended from? People say, well, those are really Israelites that took on the name Ashkenaz, but they're not really the Ashkenazi of the Bible, even though Ashkenaz and the descendants of Japheth are associated with Europeans, and these people are clearly Europeans. And when we get into the DNA, it keeps coming back European. These people have nothing to do with the Ashkenaz of the Bible. This is what they tell us. So now we have to decide, do we believe the word of man or do we believe the word of God? Because right here, by these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands, everyone after his tongue and their families and their nations. So, and then it starts with Ham. So it starts off with Japheth, calls them the Gentiles, and then it moves on to Ham and Shem. And it calls Ham and Shem, the sons of Ham and Shem, but it doesn't say that by Ham or by Shem were the Gentiles divided in their lands. See, they want to feed you this lie that everybody that's not a Jew is a Gentile. That's not true. We have the Hamites, we have the Shemites, and the descendants of Japheth were called the Gentiles. Everybody had a name for their group. We see the Gentiles are Japheth. Now we're going to see the word used differently throughout scripture depending on context, because it does mean nations, but I will show you the flaw in their argument. Now, those of you who have watched my study on the Gentiles, go watch my series on the Gentiles. I'll probably be dropping something new soon. But if you go watch my series on the Gentiles, I get into this. There's a flaw in this entire argument right here. All right, so now the flaw, for those, some of you have seen it, some of you haven't, but the flaw right here. So we're going to look at Genesis 10:5 real quick. By these were the isles of the Gentiles divided in their lands. So we come over here to the Interlinear Bible. If you go to BibleHub.com, you can pull up the Strong's, and we'll see right here. According to everyone, according to his language, according to their families, into their nations. 1471 is used. This word is going to be Goyim. We're going to see this come around. It's going to be spelled slightly different depending on the use. Goy, the I-M is the plural in the Hebrew, just like the S is the plural in English. So you have the Goy, the nation or people. You're going to have a non-masculine proper name of a people. One more time, a non-masculine proper name of a people. Not all peoples on the planet. It's a proper noun. Just like your personal name is a proper noun, or you have Israel is a proper noun. Israelites is a proper noun. So now, sometimes it is used as an improper noun. But right here, you have Goy, 1471. Nation, every nation, Gentiles, Goyim, Herosheth HaGoyim. We'll talk about that. Herds, nations, nations, people. Herosheth HaGoyim was a European settlement found in Canaan. It was discovered in archaeology. So anyway, not to get too deep into study on Gentiles, but when you get to Genesis 14, here's the flaw. So we see what it is. Goy 1471. When you get to Genesis 14, you have this War of the Kings right here. 14:1. And it came to pass in the days of Amraphel, king of Shinar, Arioch, king of Elasar, Shetalomar, king of Elam, and Tidal, king of nations, that these made war with Bera, king of Sodom, and Bersha, king of Gomorrah, Shinab, king of Adma, and Shemeber, king of Zeboam, and the king of Bela, which is Zoar. So now, you have Tidal, king of nations. If you come over here to Genesis 14:1, you have Tidal, king of who? 1471. We just said who they were. The Goyim. 1471. Tidal is the king of these people. So if they're going to tell you that Gentiles are everybody except for Israel, then they need to explain right here. Genesis 14, how do you have a king of the Goyim serving alongside these other kings? Right here. You have other kings of other places. Israel doesn't exist yet. So how is everybody in the world Gentiles? They want to feed you this lie that Abraham was a Gentile when the Bible tells us Abraham was a Hebrew. Abraham had a nationality. He was a Hebrew. But they want to tell you Abraham is a Gentile. That's how you know somebody is false teaching. There was a king of the Goyim, meaning they were a people. If everybody in the world were the Goyim, the Gentiles, prior to Israel, then Tidal would be king of all of this. Who did they serve? 12 years they served Shedolah Omar. And in the 13th year they rebelled. But who was Shedolah Omar? He was the king of Elam. Who was Elam? Elam was the son of Shem. So Shedolah Omar was the king of all kings, not in the sense of being Christ, but in the sense of physical human kingship. He was the king of these kings. And Tidal, the king of the Goyim or the Gentiles, served Shedolah Omar. But yet, if you listen to these church people, they tell you that everybody was Gentiles. If that's the case, Shedolah Omar should have been king of the Gentiles and not Tidal. So this is just some stuff to point out some inconsistencies. But now the Gentiles will come from the ends of the earth, proclaiming that their fathers inherited lies. And who do we see is among the Gentiles? Ashkenaz. What lie have they inherited? That they are the people of the book. Now, I've told y'all before, I believe that some of them, a very small number of them, might be. And we read about the some black tribe of Manasseh. So we read about that and how they mixed with the Khazars. Some of them, not all of them, a very few of them mixed with some of the Khazars, who we believe were the Ashkenazi that converted in the 8th century based on other historical evidences, not Babylon to Timbuktu, not the 13th tribe, not the invention of the Jew, not none of these books. We found other sources earlier than that that tell us this is what happened. Because they like to say they've debunked all that. Anything that attempts to tell you about real history and where these people came from, they'll call it pseudo and say it's been debunked. Because they don't want anybody tipping over their sacred cows, because they have a doctrine to hold on to, no matter if it's false or not. So the Gentiles will come and admit they've inherited lies. But see, when we talk about study, this is Blacks, Jews, the Religious Challenge, and I read this all the time. And there's a reason I read this all the time. It's because it has so much information in it. And it's published by Cambridge University. People have to say Cambridge University is not credible in order to debunk the source, and they haven't. And Ulysses S. Santamaria is the author. I'm going to read this highlighted part right here. The study of customs and rites and the analysis of the semantics of these African tribes have led many of their observers to propose some hypotheses and even draw some conclusions. Dr. Alan H. Godbey reached the following conclusion. These factors have a very specific significance if we consider the presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. The presence of Judaism among the American Negroes. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. And remember, the slave coast, where you find the kingdom of Judah, is where these people were transported from. That is the Nigeria area, the area where the Igbo live, the same Igbo who were just declared by a Sephardic Beit Din to be the descendants of Israelites in the Bible. That's where our ancestors were transported from. Now, people can hate the history all they want to and say we can't track it, but we can most definitely track it. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa at that period? To the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized during wars and sold as slaves. So when people say there were a few maybe Israelites that came over on the ship, or they were the minority, that's not what Cambridge is saying. So they need to show their research, and we've been asking them to show the source that says that there was a minority of people were Israelites on them ships. Show us those sources. Because right here, Cambridge says a majority, and somebody's lying. Either your source is lying, or this Cambridge source is lying. But we're going to get to the bottom of it. If it's Cambridge, so be it. If it's the other source, so be it. But they don't want to show their sources. They just want to throw false information out there to deceive people. And when people go out of their way to hide their sources, or they don't want to show you their sources, or you got to prove to them something before they show their sources, they are working an agenda of deception. This is why I put all my sources out for free on blackhistoryinthebible.com. You can go look at them. There is no place we can go look at their sources organized in a way in which we can go address those sources and check those sources or vet them. They just want to throw random information out and say, believe it because we said so. And then they get mad that you don't accept their God complex of believe it because we said so. So let's keep going. Where did I stop at right here? These factors, let me see. Hundreds of thousands of slaves were transported to America from West Africa during the trade, which started some 400 years ago. What traces of Judaism still remained among the Negroes of West Africa at that period? To the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized during wars and sold as slaves. It is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves to America. How many of them would have been able to conserve some Jewish customs is another question. Because you hear ignorant people out of here saying, well, why didn't they get off the boat practicing? Well, first of all, we know that most of the people taken into slavery were under the age of 20. And then they ask ignorant stuff. Why didn't they get off the slave ships? They couldn't even get off the slave ships with their own God-given names, their family-given names. They got off the slave ships with whole new names, whole new identity, whole new language, weren't allowed to read, and were split up almost immediately when they got over here. This is why an intelligent person asked, how many of them would have been able to conserve some Jewish customs is another question. Because anybody with common sense and a brain knows that slaves weren't just out there allowed to congregate and practice their religion and abstain from pork and not be raped or beaten or murdered or anything that would go against what their culture was. But you'll hear ignorant people, ignorant black people, on top of that asking stupid stuff like why can't we find slaves getting off the boat practicing Judaism? Stupid. This conclusion put forward by Godby, which argues for the existence of a more or less recurrent Judaism in West Africa in the same places as those from which Negroes were taken, is shared by others such as Maurice Delafosse, but most significantly, it has been adopted by a class of educated black Americans, as a key argument to demonstrate that the Jewish religion is the traditional religion of Africans brought in slavery to the American continent. So that is what educated people concluded to, which means that uneducated people must have concluded the opposite. I'm just saying. Now, people want to say, well, you got to keep reading. Nothing either confirms or repudiates this theory. See, they stop there and say, oh, well, it's not even confirmed or denied. But remember, this was published in 1987. So what held true in 1987 about confirmation or repudiation of the evidence or the hypothesis, as they call it, does not necessarily hold true in 2022. We have access to the internet and vastly more published sources by universities. We can see what all the scholars were putting together. So they like to hold on to this part and say, oh, well, see, this is not confirmed or denied. Yeah, in 1987, it wasn't confirmed or denied. But let's come back here. Let's look at a map of the transatlantic slave trade. It goes along with what the Bible said, that they would be taken as slaves into all nations. Prior to the transatlantic slave trade, nobody had mass targeted a specific group of people. Wait a minute. Let me go back. To the extent that they were persecuted, they were more likely than other Negroes to be seized and sold as slaves. It is virtually certain that many part Jewish Negroes were among those sent as slaves to America. So now, we know that there was the Kingdom of Judah over here. We know there were 115 towns of Judah. We know that Spain and Portugal deported Jews into West Africa. We know that some came down through Central Africa or Northern Africa into Central Africa after 70 AD and eventually ended up into West Africa. We have documents saying that there were Jews on both sides of the Niger River. We have documents saying the French called it Judah because the people were known to be tribes of Israel. We have all this documentation pointing to West Africa before the slave trade, and yet people want to say we're making it up, we're crazy, we're putting flesh above God and culture over Christ, all this stupid stuff, because we're studying history. And you will never hear them say this to a white history teacher. a white Christian history teacher. You will never hear them say that. They'll only say it to black people because they don't like where this is pointing to. And it points, literally, arrows pointing straight to the Americas and other parts. So you actually had some people who were freed from slavery before the ships got around to some of these places. But we see that people who were known to practice Judaism, living in the kingdom of Judah, were transported everywhere by ship to a place that has a big statue welcoming them, a statue based on an Egyptian peasant. And then when they get there, you have all these cities named after Egyptian things, and you have all this Egyptian architecture, you have all this Egyptian iconography, and then look, they have slaves just like Egypt. And yet people want us to think this has nothing to do with anything. Let's read Deuteronomy 28. We're coming to a close. We're going to wrap this up. Deuteronomy 28, we're going to start at verse 64 and read through 68. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people from one end of the earth even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. He's going to scatter you from one end of the earth to the other. Now, this is where people will jump in and say, well, it couldn't have meant the Americas because they have no knowledge. They had no knowledge of the Americas back then. It meant the known world. Well, no. Because if prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Spirit, then that means that prophecy is coming from God. And if you're going to tell me that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, God had to have created the Americas, which means God knew that the Americas was there. And if we read the book of Daniel, there were things that Daniel didn't understand, even though he was a prophet. He was told to tell people things that he didn't understand for his time. Moses was told to tell people things that would occur in the latter days. So the knowledge is personal, or the prophet's personal knowledge of geography is irrelevant to Bible prophecy. The collective knowledge of the time is irrelevant to Bible prophecy. That's if you believe Bible prophecy comes from God. Now, if you believe Bible prophecy comes from the prophet themselves, you have a whole different issue. You're wrong on that. Prophecy came from the Most High. And so it only matters that the Most High knew the Americas existed. So yes, he could be referring to the Americas, even though the people may not have been aware of the Americas at the time. The Most High was definitely aware of the Americas. And if you say the Most High wasn't, then you're moving into open theism, because he had to learn that the Americas existed. See, their whole theology falls apart. So when God says all nations, God means all nations to his knowledge, not to man's knowledge. And God knew the Americas was there. So when he said one end of heaven to, let me read it one more time. One end of the earth, even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. So God meant he was going to scatter them among all nations. And among these nations thou shalt find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. If you study the history, Israel was chased out of Jerusalem, and they have been fleeing ever since until they ended up as slaves all over the world, and then continued to flee from slavery. And among these nations shall thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest, but the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. Why do you think all this mental health stuff is a big deal right now? A trembling heart. Why? Because at any moment they could be lynched or murdered or beaten or raped or anything, sold off, family split apart. Constant. They were under constant fear of something happening. You don't meet your quota, you might get beat or murdered. You look wrong at a white woman, you might get beat or murdered. If the master likes your wife, she might get raped in the middle of the night, and there's nothing you can do. Same thing with your sons, your daughters. If the master thinks your son looks good, your son might get raped. Buck breaking. Look it up if you've never heard of it. They may just want to murder somebody just for the sake of murdering somebody. They may want to dismember people or torch people. Whatever they wanted to do, that's what these Europeans were over here doing. And yet the church wants to tell us, don't talk about it. Why? Because they don't want God to hear. and thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have none assurance of thy life. Who else went through this? You're going to say the other people during the Holocaust through those couple of years? This is over 400 years of history. The biblical pattern is enslavement. Israel cries out to God. God hears. He judges the nation. They come out with great wealth. The next step after that, I believe, will be the wilderness where the rebels are purged, and then Israel goes into the land. It's a pattern throughout the scripture. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were evening. So in the morning you're going to wish it was night, and at night you're going to wish it was morning. And evening thou shalt say, would God it were morning. For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee, and thou shalt see it no more again, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy or redeem you. This is why we need a redeemer. This theme of a redeemer, see, if this was translated correctly, it would be redeem and not buy. This theme of a redeemer is not just spiritual, but God redeems them from the land of their captivity, which is what the church don't want to talk about, because they know good and well those other people weren't in the land of no captivity. There's only one people living in the lands of their captivity right now. Look around the world. You see these black people in Europe, unless they migrated there from Africa, it's because they were taken there, or they traveled there from somewhere else. Their ancestors were taken in the slave trade, unless they came directly out of Africa, where they were born and raised. If they came from anywhere else, that is a result of slavery. The transatlantic slave trade, they were sold for bondmen and bondwomen. See, they want to switch it up now and say, oh, well, you'll try to sell yourselves as slaves, but nobody's going to buy you as these slaves. That doesn't make sense. People have always bought slaves. Always bought slaves. But they don't want to look at the Negro here in America, because they see that it's clearly a slavery in which we were being bought and sold and put under harsh bondage. They don't want to talk about that. That right there is critical race theory. But why are these things happening? This was prophecy that it would occur. Moses in Deuteronomy 31. We're going to wrap this up, but I just want to make sure I wrap it up real tight for those who may have missed something. Deuteronomy 31. Let me come down here. Let me make sure. Give me a second. All right. Found it right here. So now Deuteronomy 28 is the laying out of the terms and agreement. Anybody that tells you anything else is not telling you the whole story. It's the contract laid out. Deuteronomy 29, they accept it. Deuteronomy 30, there's some commentary about things that are going to happen now that they've accepted the contract. And in Deuteronomy 31, Moses gives us the time frame. For I know that after my death, ye will utterly corrupt yourselves. People say, well, what did it mean to them at the time? Doesn't matter. And turn aside from the way which I have commanded you, and evil will befall you in the latter days, or the end times, because ye will do evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger through the works of your hands. Now, if you go watch that Beyond Deuteronomy video with Jesus, Moses, and Jeremiah, I break all this down. So he's saying that evil is going to befall them. This is going to befall them in the latter days. What's going to befall them? Well, what we just looked at, Deuteronomy 28. I will scatter thee among all the people from one end of the earth, even unto the other. Thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. He's going to scatter them all over in the latter days, right? Well, how do we know this is the time period? That brings us to Luke 21, where we're going to wrap this up at. When the disciples came to Christ and they asked him, right here, and they asked him, saying, Master, but when shall these things be? And what sign will there be when these things shall come to pass? And he said, take heed that no man, that ye be not deceived. We're going to go over all these. They're all worded slightly different. And he said, take heed that ye be not deceived, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and the time draweth near. Go ye not after them. But when ye shall hear of wars and commotions, be not terrified, for these things must first come to pass, but the end is not by and by. So they're asking him about the end times. Now, he gives them a list of things to come. And when we get down to Matthew 24, right before we see right here the subheading Return of Christ, we're going to see the return of Christ after this. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword and shall be led away captive into all nations, captive into all nations. They will often leave out this word captive when they're talking about Israel going into all nations. They say, well, Israel's going to go into all nations, be spread into all nations, migrate into all nations. No, it says they will be led as slaves into all nations. Why is that important? Because when we go back to Deuteronomy 28, what's going to happen? They are going to be scattered among all nations. They're going to be brought into Egypt with ships. They're going to be sold as slaves, bondmen and bondwomen. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles, who we saw that Ashkenaz was part of, until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. So one group of people is going to go into slavery worldwide, and another group of people is going to occupy Israel until their time is fulfilled. This stuff isn't hard to put together if we just accept the Bible for what it says. But you have these people who Chuck Missler said they have a license to invent. So they reinterpret everything and say that doesn't mean that. This doesn't mean that. Well, how do we know this happens? And this happens when it happens. When we say in the transatlantic slave trade in the 1948 people, because they're asking Christ what shall be the signs, meaning this hadn't happened yet. Meaning it has to happen after the death of Christ. But why does he say it happens? For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. Well, what was written at the time of Christ? The Old Testament. So these things in the future have to be done or completed so that the things written in the past are fulfilled, which means those things were not fulfilled. And Christ saying they're going to be fulfilled at a future date. And yet people want to tell you this was all fulfilled on the cross. Why didn't he just say that instead of giving them this whole chapter of nonsense? Why didn't he just say, oh, don't worry about it, it's going to be fulfilled on the cross? See, their theology doesn't make sense. They just want to avoid stating the obvious, the truth. Their theology is false and wrong. And then after these things right here, and there shall be signs in the sun, the moon, and in the stars. Read Joel 3. Read the book of Revelation chapter 6. Joel 3 explains why the things in Revelation 6 are happening. And in Revelation 6, they acknowledge that this stuff is happening because God's wrath is being poured upon them. How do they know that? Because Joel 3 tells us that. And there shall be signs in the sun and moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distress of nations and perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's heart failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. Revelation is a book of judgment. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. So you have a judgment scenario take place. You have Israel led into captivity into all nations. You have Gentiles occupying the land. And then you have a judgment that happens. And then you see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. These things are put in order throughout the Bible. We don't have to change the order. We don't have to mess with the chronological order. We see what's going on. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. So if you are not right now with the Most High or with the Messiah, I encourage you to read Romans chapter 10, verses 8 through 13, which I'm going to do right now. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever, not Israel only, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. And it's not talking about Hellenized Israelites. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So if you are not right, I encourage you to get right with the Lord, get right with the Messiah, and believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. So hopefully you guys have learned a lot through this trilogy. Hopefully I tied it up very well. If you enjoyed the trilogy, do me a favor, hit one and hit the like button so that more people will see this. Share this video. If you didn't learn anything, press two. If you truly did not learn anything from the whole trilogy, press two. So yeah, if you guys want to support anytime during the week, you can use Cash App, hashtag BHITB. Also, you can use the Super Thanks button under the videos. Make sure you share these videos. Make sure you use the clip option too. If there's only like 30 to 60 seconds you want somebody to see, use the clip option. Click clips under the video and share that clip. It only share that 30 to 60 seconds if you want to. And don't forget, Undeniable 2 will be out this summer. So make sure you subscribe. The Olivet Discourse study is coming up soon. The True Order of Creation Part 3 is coming up soon. A lot of great material. So please share this video. Share every video in the trilogy. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel. So with that said, till next time, I'm out.